So now I leave the floor to Nicolas Terraz. Nicolas Terraz is the president of Exploration Production of Total Energy. You made a wonderful presentation yesterday. And thank you to be here for this session. And now I leave you the floor.
Thank you, Olivier. So it's a pleasure for me to be here to share a few comments about the energy context and then about what is the strategy of a company like Total Energy in this context. So, you know, when thinking about the energy context, the first point I want to make is that the demand for energy is increasing today, not decreasing. It's increasing because of population increase, particularly in emerging countries, in the global south, because of aspirations also to better living standards. So we have to meet this growing demand for energy. At the same time, of course, we have a collective responsibility, companies, government, to address the climate change. And there is a real imperative to achieve the climate neutrality for the planet. The third point I want to make is that people, they want energy, but they also want affordable energy. And it's a constant, you know, in France, in Europe, in the US, in Brazil, in Nigeria, when energy prices increase, people go to the street. So there is a need also to provide, to make energy available, but also to ensure that this energy is affordable. And all this in a system where today fossil fuel represents 80% of the global energy mix. So a growing demand for energy, a climate neutrality imperative, need to provide affordable energy, even with a massive investment required for the energy transition, on a starting point which is today 80% fossil fuel. So I think if you consider those four elements together, it gives an idea of the magnitude of the challenge that we're facing in our sector. Let me just then focus a bit on the various energies. I will start with oil. Oil today is about 30% of the energy mix. The global oil production is about, to make it simple, 100 million barrels per day. The International Energy Agency, a number of organizations, are making forecasts of what is the future oil production and when is oil production or demand actually going to decline. At Total Energies, we see more or less the oil production stabilizing over the decade and then starting to decline from 2030. To reach a level in 2050, when we aim to be carbon neutral, somewhere between 40 and 60 million barrels per day, compared to 100 today. Because there will still be a demand for oil for a number of uses that today, we don't see how they can be substituted. Now, the reality today is that the oil demand is not decreasing. So we are not yet on that decline curve. This year, the oil demand will be 102 million barrels per day, plus 2 million versus last year. So plus 2 million, to give you an idea, a company like Total Energy is producing 1.4 million barrels per day of oil globally. So plus 2 million in 1 year is 1.5 times the production of Total. And is about 20 to 30 very large projects to be started to supply that demand. So I think it's important to understand that all of us are expecting to see, in fact, a decline in the oil production, but today it's not yet the case. The demand, I talked about the demand, now the supply of oil. I mentioned it yesterday, but I think it's always important to remember that there is a natural decline of oil field production, which is much greater, by the way, than for gas. It's about 4% per year. So if you do nothing every year, out of your 100 million barrels per day, you lose 4 million. In face of a demand, that is increasing by 2 million. So that's why in our company, we're saying we need investments in new oil and gas projects. Alors we can stop investing, of course, but if we stop investing, there is very quickly a large imbalance between supply and demand, and very quickly prices are going to skyrocket, and we are back to the issue of affordability of energy and acceptability of all this. gas. So today, gas is about a quarter of the global energy mix. We see gas as a great fuel for the transition, simply because there is still a huge potential to substitute coal for gas, or coal by gas, particularly for power generation. The share of coal in the energy mix is slightly higher than the share of gas, by the way. Coal is more than a quarter of the energy mix still today. So there is this substitution. We see demand for gas actually increasing over the coming years. On a key requirement for gas to be an acceptable transition fuel is, of course, to eliminate all the methane emissions from gas production, gas transportation, and gas use, to make sure that actually gas is a positive contributor to the reduction in greenhouse gas emissions. Electricity is, of course, I would say, the core of the new energy system, because we know that electrification is going to play a super important role in the decarbonization of the energy system. It's a key lever for the energy transition. It will mobilize certainly massive investments, continue to mobilize massive investments in the future, not only in electric power generation, particularly from renewables, but also in transportation, on networks. And power systems will become more and more complex, at least as the way we see it, with the massive arrival of renewable power generation and the impact it has on the management of power systems. And what we need to remember also is that electric power customers or users, they want firm power, they don't want intermittent power, which means that even if renewables will play a very important role in the future, they need to be complemented by flexible power generation sources, so gas-fired power generation or storage, by the way. So that's what I wanted to say as a few ideas about the energy sector. And now let me move to what is the strategy of Total Energy, what we're trying to achieve in this context, which is both challenging and I would say exciting. Bon. Our strategy, we summarize it very simply by saying we want to produce more energy with less emissions. More energy for the reason I mentioned, because there is a growing demand for energy by a growing population. And in Total Energies, we expect to continue increasing our energy production while diversifying, of course, our mix with more low-carbon energy. Less emissions at the same time, and we've taken a commitment to decrease our greenhouse gas emissions by 40% between 2015 and 2030. And I will say a few words about how we're going to achieve that. But my first message is that companies like Total Energies, and I think a number of our peers actually are pursuing the similar strategies, is to be able to supply more energy to people with less emissions, which is a real challenge per se. So today, we see our future activity on our strategy based on two pillars. First pillar is oil and gas. Second pillar is what we call integrated power. So to give you an idea, today we dedicate about two-thirds of our investment, our capital expenditure program, to the first pillar, oil and gas, so about $11 billion per year. And one-third of our capital expenditures to the second pillar, which is renewable power generation, low-carbon molecules. So two-third, one-third. $10-11 billion for the first one, $5 billion per year for the second one, which in fact is a massive shift compared to where we were 5 years ago, where the second pillar was close to zero. So for the first pillar, oil and gas, of course, to achieve our more energy, less emissions strategy, we are focusing on oil and gas projects which are both low cost and low emissions. Low cost because we want our projects to be resilient through the cycles, and I don't need to tell you that, you know, Olivier mentioned about the oil price variations over the recent period, but we are in a very volatile market. So all our new projects, we've set for ourselves criteria. They need to have, you know, a technical cost below $20 per barrel to be resilient at $50 per barrel. On low emissions, because it's a way to achieve our target to decrease by 40% our greenhouse gas emissions by 2030. So what does it mean, low emissions? It means that when we look at the emission intensity of our production, so the quantity of CO2 that we emit for one barrel or one barrel equivalent produced, today the figure is 20. And by the end of the decade, our target is to reach 13 kilograms of CO2 equivalent per barrel. So to do this, we work both on our existing production base and on our new projects. Existing production base, we are basically our emissions are coming from our own energy consumption, and which is the majority of our emissions, and they are coming from flaring. So we are gradually eradicating, in fact, flaring, and routine flaring will be eradicated from all our facilities in a couple of years, even if our target was 2030. And then we are deploying new technology to stop completely flaring, including, you know, the safety flaring that we usually have in our facilities. We have systems of, you know, closed flare, where basically today we can produce oil and gas with zero flaring. Energy consumption, we are spending this year and next year $1 billion to improve the energy efficiency in our facilities. So we are doing, you know, like any industrial company willing to reduce its energy consumption. We are installing combined cycle power generation units on our offshore production facilities instead of traditional gas turbines. We are electrifying our facilities or a number of projects with renewable power generation. So we are taking care of our own emissions, you know, and of course, hoping that the energy users, our customers, will follow the same approach. One principle that we've set for ourselves is that all our new projects, oil and gas projects, must have a greenhouse gas intensity below the average of our portfolio, the average of our production. So by doing that, that's the way we can reduce gradually the emissions from our production. Low emissions for us is also aiming at zero methane emissions, because as I mentioned, we see gas as a great transition fuel, but provided we can eradicate methane emissions. So we decreased our methane emissions by half over the last decade. And our target is to further reduce by 50%, another 50% by 2025, and be near zero methane emissions in 2030. So I'm going to accelerate a bit, talk about the second pillar of our strategy, which is integrated power, as I mentioned. Electricity was about 5% of our overall production last year. And we target to bring this to 20% by 2030. Alors, some people may say 20% isn't a lot, but to go from 5% to 20%, we need to invest every year $4 billion in our integrated power business, which is probably actually one of the largest investments by a single company in Europe in renewable. In 2030, we'll have today we invest $4 billion per year. This year, we invest $4 billion in electricity power generation, mostly from renewables. So we've got this massive investment program. We are planning to generate over 100 terawatt hour of renewable electricity by 2030. But then when we say integrated power, our objective at the end of the day is not only to generate more renewable power, but is also to provide firm power to customers, which is what is required, in fact. So our strategy really is to integrate this renewable power generation with flexible power generation from combined cycle gas turbines, with storage from batteries, you know, to manage intermittency from renewables, in order to be able to deliver this firm, clean power to our customers. And of course, we're trying to build an integrated power business, which is also a profitable business, because we're a company and we have shareholders. And so we put a lot of energy and focus on, you know, producing better, developing projects better at a lower cost, and selling better. For projects, I think we recognize that, you know, there are a lot of utilities around the world which have much more experience in the electricity power business than we have. Still, we have a large offshore experience, for instance. So we try to focus on areas where we can be competitive, such as offshore wind. And of course, I will finish with that, because Olivier is telling me that I passed my time already. But we also try to develop more and more multi-energy projects. Good example of this is what we are doing in Iraq, where we have a four-component project where we develop the production from an existing oil field to generate money. And part of this money is used to gather and process a lot of natural gas that is currently being flared in Iraq to supply power generation in the country. And at the same time, we develop a 1 gigawatt solar plant in the same area, in the south of Iraq, to supply power to local people. And we believe that this kind of, and there is a fourth component, which is basically to build a large seawater treatment plant to be able to replace groundwater being used, you know, for injection into the oil field in the south of Iraq by treated seawater, and so to alleviate the hydric stress. And we believe this type of multi-energy project today is a good solution, for a responsible energy supply, and it's also a good solution for the acceptability of what we're doing. Voilà, I'm going to stop there.
Thank you for this very interesting presentation. Are there some questions on this presentation? Yeah, please, you push your button. Push the button.
Yeah, just one quick question on this Iraq thing that you mentioned about natural gas flaring. It's converting into electricity. Any plans by Total or your partners there basically to monetize even deeper and more comprehensively to convert that into LNG for export?
No, we've not. In fact, the project is ready to supply electricity for the local requirements, because the local needs are huge. And you need to know that today, Iraq, there is a lot of gas being flared in Iraq. But at the same time, the country is importing gas from Iran, in fact. So, you know, the idea is pretty simple. It's to supply gas for the local power generation plants, which are existing already, and to substitute import by local production. So no plan for LNG, simply because the demand is there.
Plan to capture all that gas which is being flared so that it can be monetize maybe for the benefit of the local population or the local economy?
Sorry, I was not clear. The plan is to collect all this gas that is currently being flared, to process it to commercial specs, and to supply it to gas-fired power plant, but locally.
Thank you very much on this talk. Jeremy Finn from Blue Water Intelligence. I have a question regarding a peak. So in any system, energy system, there is the system needs to be balanced. And you mentioned that you are developing battery capabilities to handle the peak in a low carbon way. So there are other ways. So first of all, what is the capability of your batteries at the moment? Because it's not simple technology at large scale. And are you considering other energy sources? And typically, countries look at, I mean, intermittent energies are not the solution for peak. So typically, countries look at either nuclear or hydropower to nuclear for capability, hydropower for storage, dams in particular. So are you looking at These, I believe, nuclear no, because it's written in your annual report, but who knows? It may change. And how about hydropower? Are you considering this? So three questions: battery capability, nuclear, yes or no, and are you looking at hydropower? Thank you very much.
So battery capabilities. Alors, you know, we assess it for each project, depending on what is the market, what is the demand structure, what is the pricing structure, what is the customer requirement, whether we sell on a deregulated market, you know, on a merchant way, or whether we have a PPA with an industrial customer to which we need to provide firm power. But typically, for a large portion of our new renewable projects today, we associate them with battery. And you were asking what is the size of your storage. It depends, but for a 1 gigawatt, typically for a 1 gigawatt renewable project, we'll have a storage capacity ranging anywhere between 300 to 600 gigawatt hours. So it's pretty large, in fact. So that's for batteries. Then, yes, you're right. Battery is not the only solution to manage intermittency. You know, enfin, we are doing it in a, there is pump storage, hydro, other ways to do it, and we are looking at this, definitely. We are looking at all ways, actually, to manage intermittency. Nuclear, no, we are not investing in nuclear, which doesn't mean that we don't believe nuclear is a good solution. I think nuclear is has a role to play in a decarbonized energy mix, and we certainly recognize that. But it's not our competency, you know. We are doing. We have our two pillars. We have no experience. Nuclear is complicated. And then we tend to think also for, you know, we are looking also at the long-term liabilities, and we think like for a private company like Total, managing the long-term liabilities associated with nuclear is not easy.
Thank you. Yeah, you have the floor.
Renaud Girard from Le Figaro. Should I speak French? Because everybody understands French or no? It's not translated, so I will speak English. I would like to know the impact of a small geopolitical event that happened in February 22, which was the invasion of Ukraine by Russia, on Total business. What was the shift of your business? So can you tell us the shift of business between January 21st and January 1st of January 2024? And how much it cost to the company, this small geopolitical event, and how could you face it? Did you have like reserve? Did the government help you? Did European Union help you? How did you face this this lack of this change of business?
So on this, Renaud, first, the impact on our business. I think we communicated fairly openly and clearly on what you know, what business principles we decided to apply after the invasion of Ukraine. First saying that we abide with sanctions, no matter what is the impact on our activities, and we are doing so. Second, what we did immediately was to stop, you know, purchase of oil and petroleum products from Russia. Then we started a gradual withdrawal, you know, of winding down of our activities. We had one oil production field in Russia, Karyagaz, that we sold, and we exited that. We had a gas field, you know, for domestic supply, Thermokarst, and we exited that. And then, you know, we communicated that we deconsolidated our interest in Novatek. We kept an interest, our interest in Yamal LNG, which is a liquefaction plant supplying Europe, one of our principles being that we continue to supply LNG from Russia to Europe as long as European governments actually are considering that this is desirable and that there is no sanction on that. The cost of all this, I think, is public because, you know, we took a total depreciation on Russia of $14.8 billion, to be specific, so close to $15 billion, 14.8. No, the government did not help us. It's not a practice in the company to ask for monetary support from the government. I don't think we would get it anyway, so we're trying to manage our business by ourselves. Yes, it can be the other way around.
You mean that you are not like the big banks? You don't, when you have a problem, you don't ask the government to help you?
No, no, no. There is a... In fact, so yes, it's a hit, you know, on the business of the company, but it's a hit that the company can manage. We have a limit in the amount of capital employed that we put in each individual country. So in Russia, we were, you know, at the higher end, not far from the limit, but it's a sane rule, and actually the Russian crisis has demonstrated against to us that we need to stick to that rule.
What is the cap? What is the maximum? It's 15% per country, or what?
10%.
Okay.
So that's what I can say. After, of course, there is an impact on our production. You know, Total Energy was, if you look at our reports, annual reports, we were a 2.8 million barrel equivalent per day company 2 years ago. Today we are at two. Last year we were at 2.4. This year 2.5. So there is a gap. We are developing our LNG business outside Russia. You know, so we have a number of projects. We recently announced that we joined Rio Grande LNG in the U.S. We are preparing to take a final investment decision on Papua LNG. We are participating in the very large North Field expansions in Qatar, in those six new LNG trains. We have Mozambique LNG. We are participating in expansions in Nigeria LNG and Oman LNG. So we are growing our LNG, I would say, from outside Russia. We increased actually a lot our LNG imports to Europe from other sources last year. And I think we contributed in a meaningful manner, actually, to the continuity of supply of gas to Europe. So that's the way we are doing.
Thank you. I think that's a huge, a good opportunity.